Well, that one is Benjamin Franklin. People do get us confused. We are here at the University of Pennsylvania, which has been a hotbed of controversy over political correctness. To argue the resolution resolved, political correctness is a menace and a bore. Stay tuned.
Funding for this firing line debate is made possible by a grant from the John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated, the Annenberg Foundation, the Laurel Foundation, and the Pappas Lecture Fund of the University of Pennsylvania.
Good evening and welcome to a special firing line debate. Our topic is political correctness. The exact resolution to be debated tonight is resolved. Political correctness is a menace and a bore. We come to you tonight from the Annenberg Center at the University of Pennsylvania. Anyone who has followed the political correctness debate knows that by reputation at least, we are at the heart of the beast. It was here at the University of Pennsylvania last year that a white freshman was charged with racial harassment for calling a group of black women, quote, water buffaloes. Those charges were later dropped. But that case became a symbol for those who believe there is a new climate of left-wing intolerance on America's college campuses, a climate where freedom of speech has been replaced by speech codes, where censorship flourishes in the name of racial and sexual equality. Let it be said that the University of Pennsylvania was eager to host tonight's debate, and any university that allows William F. Buckley on its campus can't be all that politically correct. There are no speech codes tonight. The only limits on freedom of expression here are the ordinary rules of civil discourse and this hammer, which I will wield strictly according to the time clock with no ideological bias whatsoever. That being understood, let's make our debaters feel welcome. I hope that's politically correct, Bill.
You are really something.
Captain of the affirmative team is, of course, William F. Buckley, Jr., founder of the National Review, founder and star of Firing Line. In terms of tonight's debate, Mr. Buckley is always a menace, but never a bore. He is the author of innumerable books. The most interesting for tonight's purposes, I think, is his very first book, written 42 years ago, called God and Man at Yale, subtitle, The Superstitions of Academic Freedom. I'll be interested to find out tonight whether Mr. Buckley still believes, four decades later, that academic freedom is just a superstition. Joining Mr. Buckley is Judge Robert Bork, now a fellow at the American Enterprise Institute. Judge Bork, of course, is best known as Ronald Reagan's nominee for the Supreme Court, who failed to get Senate confirmation after a bruising battle in 1987. Judge Bork's many admirers and supporters think of him as an early martyr to political correctness, Washington style. He'll have a chance this evening to display his judicial temperament, and you all can decide for yourselves whether that's a justified accusation. Ira Glasser is a frequent contestant on these firing line debates, rarely, however, on Mr. Buckley's side. But political correctness makes strange bedfellows. Mr. Glasser is executive director of the American Civil Liberties Union, a post he has held since 1978. I understand that if Mr. Buckley has promised that if his team wins the debate tonight with Mr. Glasser's help, Mr. Buckley has agreed to join the ACLU and carry a card with pride. The final member of the affirmative team is Catharine Stimpson, university professor at Rutgers University in New Jersey and former dean of the graduate school there. Now, the last time we debated political correctness at one of these firing line wingdings, Professor Stimpson was on the other side. Now, is she displaying an open mind, which is the true mark of the intellectual life and its highest values? Or did money change hands? I'm counting on the opposition team to get to the bottom of this one. Now, captain of the opposition team is our old friend Mark Greene, veteran of innumerable appearances on Firing Line, author of many books, candidate for many public offices. The big news for Mr. Greene is that last month he was finally elected to one of those public offices, and by a landslide, 60%, I believe. He soon takes office as New York City's public advocate, a job formerly known as president of the city council and the number two elected job in the city. Since there will perhaps, unfortunately, be a Republican mayor, that makes Mr. Greene the highest-ranking Democrat in New York City, not New York State, of course. Mr. Greene's team includes another Greene, Linda Greene, who's a professor of law at the University of Wisconsin in Madison. She graduated from Berkeley Law School, has taught at Georgetown and Harvard, and has worked for the NAACP Legal Defense Fund. Professor Greene is an expert on sports-related civil rights issues, which should prove useful if tonight's debate turns violent. Cornel West is currently a professor at Princeton and director of the Afro-American Studies program there, but he's about to move to Harvard to teach in both the Afro-American Studies department and the Divinity School. He's also taught at Yale. Here he is at Penn. It seems that Cornell is about the only Ivy League university you don't have covered, Professor West. Professor West is also the author of several books, including the best-selling Race Matters. And rounding out the opposition team is another old firing line hand, Leon Botstein, president of Bard College in Annandale, New York, and also music director of New York City's American Symphony Orchestra. As a symphony conductor, Mr. Botstein's job is to prevent discordant notes. My job tonight is exactly the opposite, to encourage discord within reason and within the constraints of the time clock. With that understanding, let's welcome Mr. Buckley to propose tonight's motion, resolved, political correctness is a menace and a bore. Mr. Buckley.
Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, my colleagues and I are here to document that political correctness has become a menace and a bore. And if it is humiliating to undertake to make that case, it is so because we contend it is manifestly the case. As well undertake to establish that Coca-Cola is a pause that refreshes, or the Democratic National Conventions are a bore. We are grateful to the University of Pennsylvania for its hospitality, as also for providing us, as has been suggested, with the handiest documentation required to make our case. It was on this campus that a group of students decided that because they disagreed with an op-ed piece published in the student newspaper, they would strike out for political correctness by simply confiscating and destroying an entire issue of the paper. Now, the difference between exertions on behalf of political correctness and exertions to maul or steal or plunder is that the latter are commonly accepted as criminal acts. But under the umbrella of political correctness, theft and the suppression of civil liberties invoke flights of ambiguity by those officials who are supposed to superintend the right to give one's opinion. The president of this distinguished university was choked up by the coils of ambiguity and finally took refuge by fleeing to Washington to serve as head of the National Endowment for the Humanities. In the federal capital, he can be protected by such as Senator Carol Moseley Brown, who last year declared that, as far as she is concerned, quote, a fundamental right is the freedom from insult. I pause, Mr. Chairman, to remark that if such a right were extended to me, I could, as author of 35 books, put half the critics in the United States in jail. And this, of course, is also the campus in which a student, weary of the noisy partying outside his dormitory by what happened to be a group of black women students, leaned out the window and asked what he termed the water buffaloes to quiet down. I confess, before I am pressed to do so by the distinguished eccentrics here today to defend political correctness, that I don't even know what a water buffalo is. But the partying ladies pressed a complaint against the student, and he was sentenced to however many days or weeks of sensitivity indoctrination composed by some administrator who is presumably an ardent enthusiast for the techniques of instruction taught in China during the Cultural Revolution. And of course, the crowning event on campus was the experience of Professor of Law Murray Dolphman. He was accused of referring to some of his students in law classes ex-slaves. He was treated as if he had been caught financing a slave ship coming in from West Africa. The university council, a group of faculty, administrators, and students that advise the president, took a straw vote on Dolphman. It was 15-4 in favor of suspending him. Much later, a report on exactly what had happened in Professor Dolphman's classroom was ruefully filed. I quote from it, Mr. Dolphman asked the class what constitutional amendment related to the concept of involuntary servitude. There was no response. Mr. Dolphman observed that if anyone should know the answer, it would be the black students. He then asked the black students of the class if they could recite the 13th Amendment.
When no one could do so, Mr. Dauphin asked one black student to stand up and read the amendment out loud. Mr. Dauphin then expressed surprise that while he, as a Jew and a, quote, former slave, as he designated himself, celebrated Passover, the black students, whom he likewise called former slaves or ex-slaves, did not celebrate the passage of the 13th Amendment. In other words, he was totally exonerated. Obviously, Mr. Chairman, we're talking about a menace to elementary canons of free life. What happened to the water buffalo student isn't a blight contained within the walls of the University of Pennsylvania. As the Wall Street Journal put it, it is important to understand how unexceptional that case was. Clearly, then, political correctness is a menace. It is also a bore in the sense that a national debate on whether we ought to retain the Bill of Rights would be a bore, or a debate on whether the multiplication tables or an insult to Senator Mosley Brown would be a bore. Mr. Chairman, I had the honor a few years ago to serve as the commencement speaker at this university, and I remember it as a happy occasion, though perhaps it turns out that this is so because I made no reference to water buffaloes. We must get on with our program, earnestly hoping that our adversaries, who certainly are not a menace, will not bore us, which reminds me of my old friend, Mr. Mark Greene.
Mr. Greene. And someone in the audience, I hope, will keep count of the number of references to water buffalo on each side tonight. We'll weigh them at the end.
Bill, friends, consistent with your opening jest, Michael, I am delighted to be part of any debate which forces conservative Republicans to become ACLUers in defense of the First Amendment. So whatever happens next, we've already won. As for the resolution, it is drafted in a typically cunning heads they win, tails we lose manner. You see, because Bill controls the defining language, which is, of course, what that team says the PCers do in that debate, our side has to prove both that political correctness is something a little less than a menace, yet more than a bore. Well, I accept the challenge to defend my goalposts within the 10 and 20 yard lines of my own side of the field. Our burden was made actually quite clear when exactly 50 hours ago, my wife actually watched Kathy Lee Gifford on television make a passing Mormon joke, at which point she caught herself and said, oh, I'm sorry, what a mistake, hold those letters, quote, isn't political correctness a bore, closed quote. In other words, it's politically correct to make fun of political correctness. Well, now that Kathy Lee has thrown in our towel, let me try to retrieve it. To me, PC, when audiences or individuals engage in a stifling conformity, a deterring or chilling free speech, can be a pain in the butt, can be obnoxious. But in our constitutional galaxy, the American ethos is cultural and political pluralism. I mean, what does liberal education mean but open and free and robust debate, out of which comes our laws, our orthodoxies, our heresies, and the ratings of firing line, such as they may be. But huff and puff, as the critics of PC might do, political correctness is not Watergate. Political correctness is not the Red Menace. Political correctness is not the invasion of the curriculum snatchers. So by the end of our 120 minutes, I hope we advance at least four propositions. First, the real menace is centuries of, or at least generations of, racial discrimination, gender discrimination, homophobia, which do produce sometimes overreaching reactions to fight just such originating discrimination. Second, the real hypocrisy are by those who egged on Joe McCarthy in the 50s against perceived pinkos, and now in the 90s condemn the unorthodox views of nominees Lonnie Guinier, of Mort Halperin, and who now, without any sense of blushing, attack others as the PC police. Who's wielding the nightstick here exactly? Third, what's really a bore are those critics who constantly recycle a few well-known anecdotes as they ignore far more frequent examples of hate speech on our campuses and in our country. And fourth and last, what's amusing to watch are conservatives desperately foraging around post-communism for a hot-button direct mail issue, deciding to pump up the volume when it comes to PC. Ultimately, they are merely playing a game of whose orthodoxy is gored. Ultimately, the war on political correctness is largely a repackaged conservative assault on liberal values, just as liberal values are becoming the majority consensus on civil rights and on choice. Or as the church lady might have said on Saturday Night Live, isn't that convenient? Thank you.
Mr. Glasser.
Good job, good job.
Make your opening remarks and then submit to interrogation by the opposition.
Thank you. Well,
your former friends of the opposition.
My former friends, yes. Well, that remains to be seen until the end. This issue is a little more complicated, I think, than either both opening statements implied. Public debate over what is politically correct or should be politically correct is a healthy thing. It's the essence of democracy. Arguing about where the line should be drawn between sexual harassment and free speech, arguing about whether affirmative action is an appropriate remedy to discrimination, arguing about whether gay people should come within the protections of civil rights laws, is a good thing for us to debate and a good thing for us to advance. The problem occurs when political correction becomes a menace, is when it is used as a device for stifling that debate, when it is used as a device for enforcing a conformity of views, when it is used as a way of cutting off the debate instead of opening it up. These are things we should be arguing about. They are not things we should be repressing the arguments about. Now, this is nothing new. What's new is the phrase political correctness, but the phenomenon isn't new. One of my leading examples of political correctness is the yellow ribbons that everyone began to wear during the Persian Gulf War. If you didn't have a yellow ribbon on, if you didn't have one tacked to your door or tied around the tree to your front yard, you were practically thought of as unpatriotic. If you advocated disarmament in the 1950s, you were called a pinko. So that meant you didn't have to confront your views. All you had to do, really, was dismiss the person. But the problem, and conservatives have used that, as Marx suggests, as a way of putting down debate. But liberals, at least some liberals, have advocated something which is much worse of a menace than that. And that has not yet been talked about. And that is the question of using laws to actually prohibit speech that you don't like, that isn't politically correct. Laws passed on college campuses all over this country, the kind of law that Canada has now, which actually makes it a crime to engage in sexually explicit expression because it degrades women. The problem, of course, is that the government gets to decide what's degrading. And now women's books and women's bookstores, including the books of women who advocated the law, are among those most frequently seized under the law. Laws that restrict speech are an abomination for a very simple reason. They're like poison gas. They seem to be a good weapon to vanquish your enemy, but the wind has a way of shifting. We should all encourage the debate about equality. We should all encourage the debate about what's politically correct. But we should all unite in opposing attempts to stifle debate, whether by law or epithet.
Thank you. Don't go away. Don't go away.
Ah, yes, they have to attack me.
Professor Greene.
Yes. Don't you think there's a little hypocrisy involved in focusing in on hate speech in the context of the political correctness debate? Surely you don't advocate that we repeal all laws which prohibit people from making false statements and security offerings. We do that because we want people to invest their money with the understanding that true statements have been made about the conditions of the company. That is a regulation of speech. There are other areas, copyright protection, plagiarism, et cetera, where we suppress speech for good ends. It seems to me if there is any end to which we ought to put any speech suppression, it ought to be the promotion of equality in society. So how do you justify our tolerance and indeed our acceptance of these other regulations on speech and yet the attack on racist speech, which would seem to embody a concern much more important than the truthfulness of a stock offering?
Well, it's very simple. The truthfulness of a stock offering is subject to objective facts about whether 2 + 2 = 4, what the ingredients are in a product that you're selling. To use the FTC-type model to deal with political speech means you have to give somebody in power, either the university president or the government, the power to define what is truth in the political realm and what is hate. Look at the problem with TV violence now. Now, there's a politically correct
issue. So you're making
issue.
A political speech distinction.
I'm making a political speech distinction at least. But the fact is that you have to be willing to give your enemies the power to make that decision, don't you? Catherine McKinnon went to Canada and championed this law to make sexually explicit expression a crime. And now her colleague in arms, Andrea Dworkin, who advocated this law, is being victimized by
it. So you favor some suppression of speech, but just not the suppression
of hate speech. I favor the suppression of speech that is in, that happens when I argue you down. I do not favor the suppression of speech that results from giving the government power to define what is permissible.
Mr. Greene.
Regrettably, I agree with you, Ira, that a false statement in an SEC disclosure can be disproven. But a racial epithet is not a statement of fact. It's just a statement of prejudice. Joe Smith hates blacks. Well, you can't disprove that. And so I don't disagree with your distinction. What I actually don't understand, though, is there is now speech which is censured by the Supreme Court. It's called sexually harassing speech in the workplace. And so how do you make a distinction between a male employee who verbally diminishes and embarrasses and coerces a female employee, which is actionable, even though it's speech rather than conduct?
Well, words themselves don't confer First Amendment protection. Extortion is a crime. Blackmail is a crime. Threatening to burn out a black family who moves into a formerly white block is a crime, even though words are used. Judge Wachler in New York was convicted of harassing a former lover of his and her daughter,
right.
But all he did was use words, right? So words can constitute harassment, but what cannot be the case is that all words that offend constitute criminal harassment. Because if that's the case, if you start talking about statutes that say anything that intends to cause emotional distress is a crime, then I gotta tell you, every time I open my mouth, I'm looking to cause someone emotional distress, and I'm doing it again. Now, all of us are out of business if that becomes a crime.
So therefore, are you saying that if a white college student is in a contained area, a room with a black female student, and he repeatedly, in a given hour or over time, makes racially slanderous remarks, no action, no conduct, but just remarks, it can rise to the level of coercion like sexual harassment and be actionable?
Sexual harassment or racial harassment or any kind of harassment
right.
can use words as part of the harassment, and the harassment can still be actionable. But words that offend somebody cannot by themselves be actionable. There's obviously case-by-case line drawing to be made. But the principle has to remain clear, or else its overbreath threatens all of our speech.
Professor West.
But Ira, though, if in fact perjury and bribery and conspiracy and false advertising are illegal, because one can point out the facts using this positivistic language, right? But somehow when it comes to morality and political dialogue, we can't point out the facts. So patriarchal put down of women are a set of lies. They're untrue, correct?
Well,
to actually say that people of color are inferior, that is a vicious and pernicious lie, as wrong as a act of perjury in a court.
But Cornel, right? Yeah. 90% of what I hear on television in political campaigns,
I think,
are pernicious lies. What are you supposed to do about that?
Yeah.
You know? You're supposed to debate it, and your way of deciding political truth are votes, but you can't give people who win the elections the power to put their opponents in jail. That happened in 1798.
I take no personal offense.
Thank you, Mr. Glasser. Mr. Professor Botstein. Make an opening remark and then submit to interrogation by the affirmative team.
Well, I'm afraid to disappoint my fellow musician, Mr. Buckley. I'm afraid this is really not about free speech at all. This is really about the nature of the university. The university regulates speech all the time. We actually have a higher standard than the street. We don't actually make a business of replicating the worst vulgarity that exists in our country. We are supposedly about truth, about standards and quality, excellence. I think very important words to the conservative side. We are also about civility, which means that we regulate very heavily what's said in the university. Someone in the physics department telling us the earth is flat, we take action. Someone who says the Holocaust didn't exist, we take action and
unless,
should.
Unless they have tenure.
And even if they have tenure, there is There's something the university has an obligation to do because we have a higher standard. If, in fact, someone said Jefferson was a woman, we'd say, well, probably not true. And there are probably rules of evidence about it. Now, what's important is this is about the standards of university. And we have an obligation to teach our students and our faculty to live by the highest standards, which for years we were taught by the neoconservatives we should really uphold. Standards of truth, standards of high values. Now, what this debate really is all about is that when a student says something that is the worst vulgar epithet, or even a mild vulgar epithet, and in fact, the behavior which we at the university have failed to control, which is the behavior of vulgarity, we have an obligation to do something about it, to create a climate where, in fact, real inquiry, debate, and dissent can take place, which is a climate that has a higher standard than the street. In the street, someone get on a soapbox and say anything she or he wants. But in university, we should actually have criteria for what constitutes the standards of discourse, and we fail to do so. I think university administrations are, in fact, at fault. But they're not at fault for trying to raise the level of discourse, which means to have codes, just as we have codes in the conduct of science, the conduct of scholarship, codes in the way we behave, comport ourselves, and deal with one another. And part of those standards are about respect for other human beings, irrespective of gender, race, and nationality, and all other distinctions. So we are not, in fact, a university or a place that simply favors one population. And therefore, I think the rules are terrible. The form of punishment, ridiculous. We are about teaching. But in order to teach, we have to establish serious standards. And that's really at the heart of the political correctness debate.
Thank you. Anybody got a question? Professor Stimpson.
Leon. How do you teach civility? How do you teach mutual respect without indulging in the most tedious and manipulative form of social engineering?
Why do any social engineering? It seems to me that if our faculty administrators behaved at the highest standards, they could teach by example. And also, it seems to me also, just as we have codes of professional conduct, which are not social engineering, in the evaluation of faculty and in the adjudication of peer review of what makes for serious science or serious scholarship, it seems to me that it's perfectly reasonable to have a set of moral and ethical standards of conduct of what it means to be a member of a university community. And if you act like essentially a vulgar, drunken fool, it seems to me that there's a serious grounds for reprimand. The reprimand should be a constructive one, not a punitive one. But it seems to me we should stand for a much higher level of behavior than we tolerate among students and faculty.
Mr. Bork.
I don't think there's any question about somebody who's behaving like a drunken fool. The question is, rather, when things are said which are not racial epithets, they are simply somebody takes objection to them because they feel hurt. There's no objective standard. It's a question of what the person who feels hurt says about it. And that has to suppress speech. Now, you talk about a code of speech. It is noteworthy that in a society, we have a First Amendment, and nobody would think of trying to draw a code of what speech may be spoken and what speech may not. There are some exceptions to the First Amendment, but no code, like a tax code.
I'm not suggesting a code of speech. I'm suggesting a code of conduct that's quite different. That is to say, I agree completely that kind of formal restriction of speech absolutely the wrong way to go. What I am arguing for is that in the context of free speech, we in the university have an obligation to make someone self-critical about what they're saying and what the impact of what they're saying might be, not to restrict it. I think that's ludicrous. So I concede that to you. What I do not concede to your side is the self-righteous assumption of a kind of blanket free speech position, because I think underneath it really is a discomfort with the fact that you're not entirely, perhaps, at ease with the notion that there has been a real history of discrimination against people of color and a discrimination against people of a different gender, and that they now have assumed some role of authority and presence in the university, and the things that we took for granted in a men's club, a white men's club, are no longer easily to take for granted. Just as a Jew entering Harvard University in the generation of Oscar Hanlon, that it suddenly was no longer de rigueur or even good to use the word kike in the common room or to make anti-Semitic jokes about how Jews being Shylocks. Well, that doesn't happen. Just as when Catholics entered the university, people stopped making jokes about popery and things which were offensive to Catholics. That is no restriction of free speech. Thank God, it's an elevation of common human decency in the university so people can conduct the real business of the university, which is scholarship and learning.
I'm glad to see you are not defending political correctness.
I'm defending what's right.
Ira Glasser. Well, I am, of course, totally comfortable with what you just said. I'm not sure anyone on this side of the panel isn't. But you are talking about something different than the controversy that has arisen. And I, just to get clear, I want to ask you this. A few days ago at the University of New Brunswick in Canada, a 27-year tenured professor of mathematics wrote an article for the school newspaper about date rape, in which he said some insensitive things. And his basic thesis was, if a female student accompanies a male student to his bedroom in the evening, she ought to understand that that's an invitation to sexual intercourse. This was greeted with such outrage that he has now been suspended, tenure notwithstanding, and the university president has said, well, not only is it an outrage to our rules, it's also a crime in Canada for him to have said what he said. Now, I take it that if a professor at Bard wrote a letter like that that was published in the Bard newspaper, that would not happen to him at Bard.
No, it would not happen to him at Bard, and I hope this doesn't happen to me. But that is to say, I don't have to make such a decision, because I think the important part, and that's the point I would like to make, is that there is a real issue when members who are of faculties do essentially blur the distinction between their professional expertise and use the station they have in a context of inequality of position to put forward things that have the air of authority that are mere prejudice and opinion. Therefore, this professor of mathematics is a fool. A fool, number one, not so much because he wrote the thing, but the fact is that it seems to me that the provocation to write this under the title of a professor of mathematics it seems to be besides the point of being a professor of mathematics, and it should have been dealt with constructively, not by suspension, not by muzzling the person, but in fact exposing the person. What we do wrong as university administrators and college administrators is we should elicit the prejudice. There's a lot of racism out there. There's a lot of sexism out there. We should bring it. This is the one place, in fact, it can be heard, but then not merely heard, but constructively
responded to
in the name of what actually is right.
I don't think there's
any disagreement. Thank you both. Thank you both. Professor Bork, it's your turn to make another name. Professor Greene. Mr. Bork and Professor Greene, if you will ascend to the podium. I guess it's not very far to ascend here. And Mr. Bork, make an opening remark, and then Professor Greene, and then you can go at each other.
Well, I hope we don't have any more watering down of political correctness in order to escape the issue, which I think just happened. Political correctness, I think, is something that's widespread in the society, and it's part of a mood of radical egalitarianism, which has taken hold. And of course, equality doesn't occur for all people without coercion. And I'm afraid that's what we're seeing. We're seeing it in affirmative action and quotas in the universities. We're seeing it in, which causes a great deal of hostility between groups. And we're seeing it in the speech codes, which are judging speech not by what it objectively means, but by how somebody perceives it, over which the speaker has no control. And I think this kind of leveling in speech and of the rejection of the achievement principle for quotas, which isn't going to work because more and more groups are demanding quotas and are becoming hostile to each other, this kind of thing, I think, leads to hostility, a loss of civility, and to a rejection of the achievement principle upon which the society is really based.
Thank you, Professor Greene.
Thank you. PC is a menace, but perhaps for different reasons than the other side would say. It's a menace because it obscures the real problems and issues that we face as a society. It's a clever rhetorical phrase which turns a debate about racism and sexism into a debate about censorship. If you can force us to discuss censorship instead of discussing racial epithets, censorship instead of discussing sexual harassment, censorship instead of discussing the question how we are going to transform our institutions into more diverse places, then you've set the terms of the debate and prevented a discussion of the real issues. And it seems to be a great cause of glee on the right among conservatives that they have been able to change this debate. Let's stop attacking young people who come to college, whose parents send them to college with a reasonable expectation that they won't be the victims of racist derogatory speech. Let's stop attacking the victims and start attacking the problem of racism. PC labels prevent that. The PC charge prevents that, and that's why PC is a menace. Let's eliminate the phrase and get on with the unfinished business of transforming our society and transforming our educational institutions.
Thank you. Professor Bork.
Professor Greene, do you think there is more racism in the society today than there was 40, 30 or 40 years ago?
I think that racism has changed its character. I think that racism still exists, but its character is different. I think we have two types of racism going on, or at least two. In one type, we see the explicit racist remark or the explicit racial decision, sometimes because of an inadvertent slip or recording, etc. Other times, we have a veiled racism, not necessarily the product of a person's specific intent, but an unconscious comfort which we have with the status quo. I think what we need to do is not to focus on calling each other racist or sexist, but instead to try to understand how historical racism has affected our lives and consciousness, and not make charges, but try to understand how we all, white, black, men, and women, have been affected by our past.
Is it your understanding, Professor Greene, that you are actually defending political correctness with that statement?
I'm not defending political correctness, but perhaps what you mean, you're asking me questions, I'm sorry. Perhaps what you mean by political correctness is the idea that there are certain things we should not do or should not say. I think that to transform the debate about eliminating inequality, eliminating discrimination in education and employment into a debate about political correctness is a mistake, and it's unwise, because what it means is that we are going to perpetuate the problems of the 19th century into the 21st century. And what we need to do is to work together to solve those problems by openly discussing them, not by covering them up with a PC label.
Professor Greene, I think none of us on this side of the table disagrees that people could be punished for making open racial or ethnic insults in a university. The question is, that is not the question in which this arises. This arises when students steal a student newspaper because they regard it as racist, although it's just conservative, or when a professor is put through sensitivity training for a remark that was not really offensive in the classroom. That's political correctness. And well, that's what we object to, and it's happening. It's not just a question of forbidding talk about racism.
Well, is it political correctness because the university expresses a concern? It seems to me that if we eliminate the label of political correctness from our debate, we can talk more explicitly about what speech we want to empower people to engage in. Let's stop talking about political correctness, and instead talk frankly about what we want people to be able to say at the university. Are we saying that we want students to be able to say anything they wish to another person? Are we saying that we want faculty to be free to make remarks, however offensive or threatening to their students? Are we saying that we want professors to be able to make sexual remarks to their students? All I'm saying is that the PC charge prevents us from discussing the rules of decorum in the university. I think that when you mention acts like the stealing of newspapers or other acts of this nature, we all understand that these acts occur in a context from what I have heard here, that the act, that the context in which this particular theft occurred, and I am not defending the theft, but the context was one in which the newspaper was thought to be hostile to the concerns of these students, and that they had tried in many ways to engage the publishers of the newspaper in a dialogue. So, you know, it's hard. I don't think we want to continue to focus on the specific incidents. I think what we need to talk about is the way that political correctness, the charge, the characterization of this debate prevents us from really discussing how much freedom a professor should. We've both been professors. I'm a professor now. You've been a professor. You know how important it is to be free to speak and to not be misunderstood.
Well, I think you
and I support that totally.
You
that freedom.
You and Leon, well, you and Leon Botstein ought to be on this side of the table.
Well, we
maybe
did,
maybe
we,
the others should too, because nobody on this side of the table is saying we should not discuss racism or sexism and how to deal with it.
But what I'm saying is that the PC charge prevents us from having that discussion. It turns the question of inclusion, of empowerment, of freedom from racial epithets and sexually harassing comments into a debate about political correctness instead
okay.
of a debate about
you,
those
don't
issues.
Go away. You can go on the you can start attacking him. I just want to break from format just briefly to ask Ira Glasser, is Mr. Bork correct that everyone on this side agrees that it's okay to punish a student for making an overtly racist remark?
No, I didn't say that.
I said a racial insult. A racial insult.
And no.
Well, I think you may have less allies than you think, Professor Bork. But go ahead.
But you
That's
can come
typically
to our
the
side.
Case. Yeah. You know,
Judge Bork, I invite you
go
to
ahead.
Take my seat on
no,
my
go
side.
Go ahead and interrogate Judge Bork.
Yes, sir. Judge Bork, don't you think that there's a great deal of hypocrisy in the free speech debate? We don't have an outcry over the regulation of speech in the context of stock offerings. We don't worry about regulating speech in the area of copyright, plagiarism. Some of the conservatives are perfectly happy to suppress pornography and obscenity or other types of advertising, etc. So how would you make the distinction between that speech which ought to be permitted and that speech which we ought to suppress?
At the core of the First Amendment, which I take it is the emblem of free speech in our society. At the core of the First Amendment, there is concern for political speech, concern for speech about ideas, about social matters, and so forth. There is no concern about speech, there wasn't originally concern about speech, which doesn't expresses no idea, but merely expresses hatred or obscenity or something of that sort. And therefore, I think it's quite easy to say that speech. If somebody says, for example, that Asian American students turn out to be better at mathematics and physics than others, I take it a speech code might land upon that person. That's political correctness, and that's wrong. We ought to be free to discuss differences, abilities, and so forth. But when you get to a code about a stock offering, you're merely saying don't sell somebody a product that you have lied about.
Well, I'm still wondering how you make the distinction between what distinction you would draw. It seems that you're supporting the idea that we can regulate some hate speech, that which constitutes perhaps
in the university,
and hate speech which might be one person making a personally directed racial epithet at another person. Wouldn't you agree that that ought to be if not punishable, certainly subject to some type of university discipline and correction?
There certainly ought to be. I remember there was an episode at Brown University not long ago in which a drunken student went out in the quadrangles and shrieked anti-Semitic remarks. And the dean had him in, and I think he was suspended. I don't have much trouble with that.
Okay. Well, at the University of Wisconsin, we had a problem with our speech code, our original speech code, because it did seem to permit the suppression of speech, which was not directed at an individual. And arguably, in the opinion of the judge who reviewed our first code, it would probably prevent discussion and be much broader than the fighting words justification included in the famous Teplinsky case. And so I was a part of a team of people who rewrote that so that it would only cover that speech which was directed at a specific individual which would be likely to provoke violence. So would you agree that that type of narrow tailoring, leaving free a full range of debate on issues of importance to all of us, race, gender, et cetera, would be an appropriate way to resolve this debate over free speech?
What you're describing, I think, is First Amendment doctrine, which is that if speech becomes something that is likely to provoke a fight of that nature, it may be censored.
I still want you to come over here.
No, you're over here.
I think you're both over here.
How do you... how do you explain that there is so much intellectual and political firepower marshaled in favor of people who want to yell epithets and derogatory, hurtful language? How do we explain this marshaling of energy and intellect in support of people who want to act this way towards others?
I think nobody here does, unless possibly Ira Glasser does. But I think nobody does.
Well, then would you agree with me that what we need to do is talk about the real issues and stop hurling our charges at each other?
Oh, well, charges are much more fun.
Oh, right. Dear.
Thank you both. This is a very alarming development. It's never happened before in one of these firing line debates. We're getting close to agreement, and we still have half the debate to go. See what you can do about that, Mr. Buckley, and submit to interrogation from the Professor Botstein.
Yeah, maybe I can help out, too. Your colleague, Judge Bork, said a most amazing thing, which I think is part of the essential argument on your side. The idea that the speaker has no control over the impact of her or his words on someone else. Now, that's an interesting statement. Do you really believe that, in fact, when you say something, you are not in any way ethically or morally responsible for anticipating, especially if you are a teacher in university or a person, another roommate, what someone else... how someone else might react to what you say?
I think there are too many variables to make it possible to predict. I've said an awful lot of things in the last 40 years, and unhappily, there hasn't been the kind of reaction I would have hoped.
Slavish agreement was what you were hoping for?
It's quite true that some people have a hidden sensitivity about a particular subject, and you bring it up, and they're terribly offended. On the other hand, what is required there is a cosmopolitanization of society rather than any ersatz efforts at a protection that doesn't work.
No, but you don't think a teacher has an obligation to think about what it is she or he says, what kind of impact it might have on a bunch of graduates or undergraduates?
A teacher has an obligation to be as exemplary in his behavior as you regularly are, and as I'm sure Professor Greene regularly is. But we're talking about those teachers who, in pursuit of their ideas of equality, end up being hypercritical towards people who, however eccentrically, express their own disagreements. I don't think that people should have been exercised when somebody called them a water buffalo and asked them to shut up. And yet that was a real incident in this real place.
What about Mr. Glasser's math professor?
What about what?
Mr. Glasser's math professor.
What did he say?
He was the one who wrote a letter to the school newspaper on the subject of date rape.
I think the cultural background of that situation is entirely determinative. I don't have to instruct you in the matter, but there are situations in which if certain invitations are accepted, this is exactly what is intended. Now, don't tell me that your experience is so limited that you have neither read about those or imagined them, obviously not participated in them. But the answer is there are certain circumstances in which a woman accepts an invitation at a certain time to a certain place, like a motel. This is exactly what she anticipated.
Well, how about in these circumstances, Bill?
What?
Let me give you circumstances.
This part of it. Yeah.
If you don't want to take the bait on the date rape circumstances, let's talk about the racial circumstances. Judge Bork said that he agreed with Brown University when it suspended a student for uttering anti-Semitic remarks. My question is, do you agree with Judge Bork? And if not, how would you handle an incident like that?
I don't think that anybody has the right to be drunk and disorderly in a community that seeks to maintain certain standards. I don't think, however, this was a question going after him for politically correct. If instead of being anti-Semitic while he traipsed through whatever drunken hole or whatever hole he traipsed, he had attacked the Indians or the Peloponnesians, it was his behavior that got him bound.
You can't get off the hook. Suppose he was not drunk and calmly walked across campus uttering anti-Semitic and racist comments. Would you suspend him? And if not, how
absolutely
would you handle
not. Him? Absolutely not. All what right. he should do is suffer the consequences of social ostracism. People to say, look, we don't like people like you.
Professor West.
I have an incident that's closer to home, and it has to do, of course, with the Dartmouth Review cartoonish portrait of the distinguished president of Dartmouth, who was Jewish, and that cartoonish portrait was one of Hitler in light of an elective affinity to that president. Now, Dartmouth Review, you have a cozy relationship with in the past. What response did you actually put forward in relation to
that? Well, I took the trouble to examine the circumstances of which
you interpreted
which
the
manifestly you did not.
You interpreted the
this was actually drawn by a Jewish student, by a paper that had come out for Israel over the years, which had a Jewish editor-in-chief the following year, and it was a sophomoric play on a Hitler. If you think, if you think that Hitler can't be used in sophomoric ways to prove a particular point, you're simply inexperienced, Professor West.
How did the distinguished president perceive it, though, Mr. Buckley?
What's that?
How did the president who was the object
I think
of
it was in bad taste. I wrote a book in which
I said
it was in bad taste.
But, Bill, bad taste? Hitler's not something to play with.
Who's
not bad taste?
In the first place, I agree he's not something to play with, but
yes.
The question is, how should we deal with people whose taste is so misbegotten on a particular moment as to do that? Some people play with the Virgin Mary, and nobody thinks of dismissing them. Some people play with the Holocaust. These people deserve to be told to grow up and to observe better standards.
Thank you very much, Mr. Buckley.
You through with me?
You're all done. Grow up. Mark Green. I submit to the interrogation of the affirmative team. Someone have a question for Mr. Green? I guess you
won.
I don't blame you.
I guess I'll take the, the answers we anticipate is causing us to hesitate.
Sure.
I want to pick up Leon Botstein's comment about the way people receive or perceive a remark, because of course anybody tries to take into account the way reasonable people would take a remark. But we're now a nation that everybody's claiming victimhood and the right to feel hurt by all kinds of things. And it's that kind of thing, which the speech codes try to prevent, which does, I think, suppress speech. And I want to know if you agree with that.
I do. Lawyers call it a heckler's veto. I could say something perfectly innocuous, but if one person in this audience got offended by calling them a TV monitor, could that person silence my speech on behalf of all the others? That is why I am against speech codes. It's too subjective. You cannot have any standard that could be uniformly enforced. Second, if you had some kind of speech code to protect, hypothetically, minority students, my guess is in our society, it would be more often used against minority students in the future. A black woman yelling Polak to a cop in Chicago would be more likely prosecuted than a cop yelling nigger to a black woman, so I want none of the speech codes, unlike you, who said that you would, unlike Mr. Buckley, have sanctioned the Brown student for uttering anti-Semitic remarks. I agree with Mr. Buckley. Let social obloquy deter him rather than formal law enforcement.
We're not talking about just uttering this. These were shouts in the middle of the night that you heard all over campus. That's confrontational.
You're fighting the hypothetical. I said non-drunk midday.
Not okay.
Which is more common.
If he shouted.
Catharine Stimpson.
Mr. Green, I think our moderator said something absolutely true. This may be a first for a firing line debate. There's a lot of agreement between the tables. So I'm going to shift from the question of speech codes to something that hasn't been raised here so far. If we agree on so much, why has PC become this international phenomenon? What reasons do you adduce for the fact that we're sitting here talking about it at all?
PC, political correctness, was a term first used by leftists years ago to mock colleagues who took their ideology veering to the cliff or beyond the cliff of self-absorption, self-righteousness, and intolerance. This is what the left gets for being honest. The phrase was kidnapped by the right wing, and suddenly when it's well-funded by the Heritage Foundation, by the Wall Street Journal editorial pages, it becomes a topic of a person, an eminent conservative, who designs the topic of this show. Notice, Mr. Buckley didn't design the topic. Is hate speech a menace? The topic was, is political correctness a menace? I would argue, Mr. Buckley's brilliance notwithstanding, that John McLaughlin has 3 shows, Pat Buchanan has 2, Bill Buckley has 1, and there are so few TV shows on the other side
the
that the
news.
Debate has been hijacked.
Anyone else have a question?
Yeah, Mark.
Glasser.
I want to follow up on and get your views, as long as we're agreeing and disagreeing with our opponents and our colleagues here, with something that Linda Greene said. She suggested that speech which was directed at an individual that was likely to produce a violent reaction in that individual could be censored. My experience is that most of the arrests for speech and demonstrations in the 60s and 70s resulted precisely from the fear that civil rights demonstrators would provoke Southern whites to violence, that anti-war demonstrators would provoke police to violence, that if you called the president a war criminal or a cop a pig, it would promote violence, and therefore they were arrested on that ground. We always defended them on the grounds that the role of the police was to protect people who speak against the violence that they provoke, not to repress the speaker in fear of it. What's your view on that?
I agree. This is why I'm an occasional dues-paying member of the ACLU. So the ACLU's principled an enormously unpopular stand in Cicero, where when Nazis marched, it was frankly likely they could provoke a response by any citizens, much less Jewish citizens. You took the right speech position.
Skokie, you mean?
Okay. I'm sorry, in Skokie. Forgive me. You can't leave it up to the subjective editorial opinions of listeners who should speak and who should not speak. I don't trust anyone to make that judgment, and the standards are used against the audience you want to protect, and the reverse is true. In the case in the 30s against the racist Father Terminello, I believe, the protections established by allowing him to speak were later used in the 60s and 70s to protect civil rights demonstrators in the South.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It's now Catharine Stimpson's turn to, I believe, yes, to ascend to the podium and make some opening remarks.
Give me a hug, Catharine.
Where did you get such a reasonable group of people? Why didn't you get somebody else?
They wouldn't come.
Well, my team leader has just told me to give him hell, and so I'm going to start by taking a take on this question that my team leader did not. Well, today, using the term political correctness is the verbal equivalent of mud wrestling. Like mud wrestling, the term political correctness is slippery, loose, dirty, and hyped. But despite the hype, it is also dull, dull, dull. And for these reasons alone, the term political correctness would be a cultural menace and a bore. But lots of people seem to enjoy mud wrestling for diverse reasons. And similarly, lots of people seem to enjoy using the term political correctness for diverse reasons. Indeed, the term is so pervasive that it appears in the 1993 Christmas windows of Macy's on 34th Street in New York. But here are 3 reasons why the term has become as common as dirt. 1, the groupthink of political correctness is there, on the left and on the right. 2, and more important, after 1990, the media spread a scare story about the term PC on the left, and the story stuck. Reason 3, even more important, current social movements, for example, the movement for racial and gender equity, make people nervous. And it's easier to dismiss these movements as PC than to wrestle with them courageously. So let's close down the boring mud wrestling ring called the PC Wars. Let's focus on real menaces. Fundamentalist groupthink anywhere, media scandal mongering, violence, and prejudice.
Thank you very much.
All right.
I'm not sure which side of the debate you'd fall on with that.
Mr. West, Mr. Greene, Mr. Botstein,
we
Ms.
want
Greene.
To invite Let's you go. Over also. I think you agree certainly with my position that the PC charge is obscuring the debate. Why do you think that the charge, the tactic of charging PC is so incredibly attractive? Why is it so attractive? And isn't it better for us to eliminate it from our vocabulary altogether and discuss the underlying issues which you so eloquently outlined?
Oh, Linda, once thought we could eliminate the term PC as political correctness, and we could think of PC as personal computer or pluralistic cultures. But I was a mistake. But why is it captured the imagination? Why has it become a common term? I would suggest two reasons, both of which have been mentioned here before. One, there was a media hype. Let me give you some statistics from a study that was done of PC. In 1988, in the media, there were 101 articles about PC. In 1989, there were 306 articles. In 1990, there were 656 articles. And in 1991, there were 3,989 articles.
Well, Catharine, can we talk about what the people who charge PC want the students to be able to discuss? Are you suggesting that we return to an open debate in our society about the legitimacy of our equality laws, about our public accommodations laws, about our employment discrimination laws? I mean, what is the debate which the people who charge PC feel is being stifled? What is the discussion that they would like to have which is being suppressed?
Linda, I think lots of people, different people, charge PC. There is no monolithic charge of PC, and different people are worried about different things.
And but you agree that it's covering up our...
Mr. Botstein.
Can I just finish this, because
sure.
This is an important point.
Briefly.
So anyway, people have different reasons. They're afraid of different things. But what I said before, I want to repeat. I think too often, the charge of PC is used, not only for political purposes, but to help us evade the hard, hard issues we have to confront as a free, democratic, multicultural, pluralistic society.
Mr. Botstein.
Yeah, I'm going to switch to the other side here. I hear you talk. I suddenly want to. You should be here, and I should be over there for the following reason. You know, I think the problem with PC is that it probably is the greatest indictment of the low quality of American universities. Really, what this is about, more than anything else, to my mind, if you've been in university a long time, is that it has never been any different. That is to say, we do not foster a climate in which real dissent can take place. Nobody really wants to discuss real issues. And therefore, it used to be somebody else. Now, the victims of this PC, to some extent, are real diverse discussions about questions of race and gender. So it's very hard to question the things you just mentioned, because that's the subject. But has it ever been any different in your own experience in the university? Have we ever accomplished in the American university in the 50s at Yale or any of our alma maters, was there ever really a time in which the American university fostered serious debate about so-called taboo subjects? Has there always really been a low level of groupthink?
We got the question. Let's get the answer.
Leon, you're a college president, and I make my living as a college professor, and I'm not going to foul the nest. I think the universities and colleges are better than you just gave them credit for being, and I think they have gotten better since the 1960s. I think there is a level of debate about curricular and intellectual and social issues that simply was not there in the 1950s. But am I going to advocate perfection at the University of Pennsylvania or any other institution? No. And indeed, part of our job is constantly to remind people of the ideal of civil and free discourse at the university, so we can continue to work for it.
All right, thank you very much.
That's over?
Hey, you're over. You're home free.
That's an extra time.
Cornel West, it's your turn. It's your turn to come and make an opening remark.
You say what?
It's your turn to come make an opening remark.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah. You have the floor. You can say anything you want, direct it to anyone you wish.
Well, I think Leon's point about the low quality of life in the university is only a version of the low quality of public debate in the nation. And the low quality of public debate in the nation has to do with the degree to which dogmatism and orthodoxy and rigidity and self-righteousness trump conversation and foreclose dialogue. And therefore, when I see Mr. Buckley, my friend Mr. Buckley, running to the barricades to defend victims and oppressed people, I'm always a bit suspicious. Precisely because when we look at political correctness from above, as opposed to political correctness from below, because below we're dealing with the pernicious legacy of white supremacy and male supremacy and homophobia, those people who have been degraded and have been oppressed institutionally as well as targeted with epithets. But when we look, for example, at the courts in the 1980s, over 100 judges chosen for the courts of appeal, and only 2 were black, and 1 was Clarence Thomas. Is that political correctness from above? Interesting question. When we focus on black students here at University of Pennsylvania, who wrongly did what they did, but Mr. Buckley and others make it as if they are subverting the legal order, but not a mumbling word of critique of Oliver North. Hypocrisy begins to surface. In terms of if we're going to talk about critiques of orthodox and rigidity across the board and broaden the possibility of public debate, not just in the university, but in our society as a whole, including electronic media. Michael, I know you're on the left. And cross.
Go ahead, criticize. I'm powerless.
I want you to be left, 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 but that's another issue. Michael. The point is that we cannot allow any label, PC, whatever, left, right, center, to hide and conceal the hunger that ordinary people have. Only 25% of American people even go to college. 75% are hungry for dialogue. Look at the talk shows, you see. Radio, TV. They want public conversation. They don't just want name calling and finger pointing that they often get, you see. And if that's the case, and we might be able to get beyond PC and deal with these deeper issues that have much to do with what Mr. Bork calls radical egalitarian sensibility.
Okay, don't go away. Any finger name pointing or finger calling, whatever.
Professor West, first of all, thank you for the lecture.
Let me ask you this:
Are we permitted to ask whether obviously well-qualified black judges were overlooked because they were black, or might it be for other reasons?
Oh, no, we certainly have to acknowledge our meritocratic criteria. We just don't want it to be pigmentocratic.
Well, I say, are we allowed to discuss the question?
Of course we are. I've argued quite explicitly Clarence Thomas was not qualified, right?
Look, you just...
That was part of my argument in my text. Yeah.
Let's not make this hit and run. You just implied that the last two administrations didn't appoint obviously qualified black judges because they were prejudiced, to which I say, where is your evidence for this? And aren't you a little bit ashamed of having made that charge in the absence of such evidence? Because this makes you, this makes you ceteris paribus yourself a racist.
Well, I certainly don't want to be a racist. You and I are Christians. We know how serious that charge is. But my question to you, though, Bill, would be, what kind of evidence would be sufficient for you? How many judges would have to be
Well, much
chosen?
More than you have, because you say that Clarence Thomas is not qualified. I think he's highly qualified.
Well, we disagree. We disagree.
I and the Senate agree, and my brother, who sat next to him on the court for a couple of years, agree that he was highly qualified. On the other hand, we might disagree about Judge Bork. Was he qualified?
Watch it.
We had a wonderful conversation a few minutes ago. Yeah. Oh.
You don't have to. I'm ruling from the floor. You don't have to answer that.
I'll put
that.
It this, though, that I have read Judge Bork's essays. There's an intellectual rigor there. I violently disagree with the conclusion that he draws.
Even as a Christian?
Even as a Christian and a human being and a black American.
I think Judge Bork's a different kind of case, because I'm talking about meritocratic intellectual criteria, and that's simply my political disagreements with Judge Bork.
Ira Glasser.
Cornel, we have agreed on a couple of things here this evening. One, that laws that try to restrict speech in the name of politically correct thought are impermissible. And we've also agreed, at least you and I have, that using politically correct as an epithet to hurl at someone sort of is a showstopper. It cuts off debate instead of opening it up.
That's right.
I think we also agree that it is critically important. I suppose we would both be characterized as radical egalitarians in Judge Bork's phrase. It is critically important to discuss those issues across our differences, racial,
absolutely,
religious, sexual, political.
As citizens, what is
the public
mind?
How would you propose to do that, particularly in the context of the university where a lot of students come together who come from very parochial upbringings and communities where the differences they confront at school are sharp and new? How would you do that without the sort of imposition of codes and rules and punishments that we oppose?
Leon was getting at something very important. And I think about my experience at Harvard College when I arrived in Sacramento. It was a liberating and emancipating experience as I was able to bring critique to bear to my own very rich but narrow parochialism, with all the rich black love that I received, but still part of a world that needed broadening and refinement. If, by example, professors, administrators, could exude that sense of liberation and emancipation in terms of their reveling in dialogue with agreeing to disagree radically and so forth, then maybe that could become contagious and the students would see, lo and behold, there is an experience here that I'm missing out on. And I think many persons who matriculated through colleges in the 60s and 70s felt that sense of discovery, that life was an adventure, that one could be improvisational and experimental. Unfortunately, many students don't feel that.
What about required courses?
Stop right there and answer it very briefly, please.
Depends on how good the courses are.
Good, thank you. Mr. Buckley, it's your turn, and Mr. Greene, it's your turn for the team captains to interrogate each other, starting with Mr. Buckley interrogating Mr. Greene.
Mr. Greene, your colleague, our professor Greene, said a moment ago that she didn't think it was proper to permit people to revisit such basic questions as the civil rights laws. Now, we all recognize that the civil rights laws, notwithstanding that Senator Humphrey didn't so intend, to have generated a thing called affirmative action. Is this something which, in your opinion, we can discuss without offending Professor Greene's code?
Yes.
Well, do you want to...
In other words, of course you can revisit it. You shouldn't chill it. Some things are largely settled issues. The First Amendment should have been the first. It was a bulwark of liberty. A popular election for senators is better than state legislatures electing them, although in my state, that's half the senators would argue for going back to the old version. But basically, Bill, some things are largely settled. 99% of the country, George Bush opposed the Civil Rights Bill of 64. He says he made a mistake. That may also be true of Judge Bork. I don't want to misspeak, but in your hearings, I think you said a similar thing. Why waste your time on going back on settled issues when there is current problems that cry out for
lots of people waste their time. That's their business.
Well, we're firing one. Here
we are. We wouldn't want to live. Some people keep running for office, waste it.
Watch it. This time I got four times your vote, Bill.
Well, now, let me ask you this. We have all joined in denouncing epithets. I toured around a little bit, as no doubt you did, assuming you were adult at that point in the late 60s. It was very hard to run into any campus in which Lyndon Johnson and the majority of the Senate weren't referred to routinely as war criminals. What should we have done about them? Should we have said, look, you can't engage in that kind of invidious talk here. You should be kicked out. Or what, should we suspend them? Or
this is a very good question. We should have voted them out of office, which is what happened. Richard Nixon, ironically, was the beneficiary. I was a college student in the late 60s. I now visit campuses. There was much more intolerance in the late 60s. More was at stake. Hundreds of thousands of Asians, tens of thousands of Americans were dying. It wasn't we were debating should Catharine Stimpson be called a chair or a chairwoman.
I don't want you to talk about the Vietnam War. I want you to ask the question, what do you do about people who denounce the President of the United States and a bunch of senators as war criminals. Do you say, don't do that? Or do you say, think before you do it? Or do you say, as a matter of fact, you're right?
Well, it depends on the charge. You can't say,
that is the charge.
1 second. I earlier said a student at Brown could yell a racial epithet and not be suspended. So I think a student should be able to yell Lyndon Johnson was a war criminal, not be retaliated against. That's why we had teachings. That's why we have why we have elections.
Since war criminals, to the extent that we've had intimate experience with them, get hanged, then to call somebody a war criminal is a pretty serious charge.
Of course it is.
And so, none of the charges that we have here denounced tonight is really quite equal in gravity to that. So therefore, do you wish to reject the company of your colleagues who say that something indeed should be done at people, about
the
people?
The only person in this room who so far has said there should be a speech code sanctioning racial epithets or war criminals is Judge Bork, notwithstanding your injunction and your resolution. So you're trying to trap me. I happen to agree with you on this. More speech is better than less speech. And in fact, if someone makes a racial epithet or a war criminal statement, most people would reject it because it's self-impeaching. And that's the reason we have a First Amendment and not a star chamber.
Okay, you can now go on the offensive, Mark.
So therefore, you should increase the gravity of an epithet. In order to be immune, you should increase the gravity.
You use up your time. You're running the show, but not for the next 4 minutes and 14 seconds. Bill, Professor Greene and myself and others had said that the PC usage of PC is a conservative rhetorical device to get away from fundamental issues of race and power and talk about censorship. Question, Serrano, Mapplethorpe, controversial artists a few years ago. Do you agree with the Jesse Helmses who wanted to censor them, or do you think, or would you defend them because Helms was engaged in conservative PC?
I would certainly not defend the use of my money to subsidize that exhibit, no. If you want to show his pictures with tails coming out of his rectum, go ahead and pay your own money for it.
All right.
But don't tell me that I ought to contribute to a fund to make this possible.
All right. There was a law before it was overturned banning the symbolic speech of flag burning. What was your position on
who?
There was a law before the Supreme Court overturned it prohibiting flag burning. What was your position on that law?
Who's he?
He's Mark Greene.
Flag burning? prohibit
flag burning.
You know, the issue flag you burning. And I debated on a different show.
Flag burning? Burning the American flag?
Flag burning. Yeah. I thought you were talking about a guy. Well, I think the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court was correct when he wrote, however it was a minority opinion, that the First Amendment ought not to be extended to cover the defamation of a national symbol, if indeed Congress thought it ought not to be. In other words, he said that the law against the burning flags was not a violation of the First Amendment. He was overruled, but I don't think that intellectually he was made to seem stupid. For one thing, he isn't.
So you would want to suppress speech because it would insult the conservatives, because but not suppress racial
Mark,
speech.
Careful,
what's
careful.
The distinction?
I wasn't talking about speech. I was talking about burning flags, which is not speech. I can be a deaf mute and burn a flag.
1 second. If I burned the cloth, it wouldn't be obviously a violation of that law. The only cloth that you burned that would violate that law is with stars and stripes and banners. And so you can't get away from the fact that burning a flag insulted the sensitivity and sensibilities of many Americans, just like racial epithets insult people. Don't you want a speech code when it offends your conservative sensibility?
No, I think when people draw swastikas on synagogues, there ought to be some recourse that says you're not protected by the First Amendment in doing so.
Bill, you have some of the critics of these codes have called PCers McCarthyism of the left. You have called McCarthyism largely a historic fiction.
I wrote a book about McCarthy, so be very careful.
I know that, Bill. I do this with full knowledge and trepidation. During the McCarthy era, there were people in Hollywood and in the Academy who were fired and who were ruined. Could you tell me how many conservative professors have been fired and ruined because they said impolitic, anti-PC things?
I don't know, but I have here a list of somebody, Mr. Draper, who was the only person who wasn't given tenure in his particular university because he said something that was unpopular.
One.
Now, I don't know what the motives were. Obviously, they said they had nothing to do with it. If you say, why wasn't Mr. So-and-so, I have somebody in mind, Mr. So-and-so promoted at Yale, was it just an accident that they were conservative in their inclinations or that they were pro-Christian?
Bill, in the last...
The answer is I don't know, but okay. You and I both know that plenty of people haven't been promoted because of their opinions.
I don't know that. Bill, last
well,
question.
Well, let me instruct you. It is so.
You obviously don't have their names here. Bill, I've been on a lot of programs with you, and I want to ask you, Professor Greene said the larger problem is racial and gender discrimination. Even if it's not as bad as 30 years ago, and I agree with Judge Bork, how big a problem is this in this country today?
I don't think it's a big problem. No, on the contrary, it seems to me plain that an enormous effort has been made to affirm and advance the rights of ethnic minorities. And I don't know of any woman at all, including the ones who rule my life, who are effectively discriminated.
All right, thank you very much. It's now Ira Glasser and Leon Botstein's turn. And Mr. Glasser, you can question Mr. Botstein for a few minutes.
Oh, good. Since you're the only university president among the eight of us, I get to ask you a question I have asked many university presidents, but never in public before, which is...
I don't like this.
I'm going to give you a great opportunity here. I want to talk about and ask you questions about real remedies to the underlying problems. I agree, though for different reasons, with Professor Greene that the hate speech code has been a diversion from coming to grips with the underlying problems which produced the speech codes in the first place. How would you deal, since I know you're opposed to speech codes, how do you deal with that at Bard? For example, would you consider a required course in the history of racism and civil rights in this country?
First of all, I'm not a university president, only a college president, so that reduces me in importance, I hope. The second thing is that I think a required course is besides the point, largely because it's not clear to me that a course in racism or a course in such a matter is anything but a kind of very bizarre ghettoizing of the issue and can deteriorate, as Cornel West, into a bad course, which is merely preachy in a way. The real problem has to do with the attitudes that people bring to the university campus and college campus and their inability to really question them and attempt a different way of dealing with these very important issues. There is prejudice of all kinds. And what I would recommend is that we create a climate quite opposite what we have now, where this stuff is encouraged, but then responded to. That is to say, where people actually sit and listen. I want to extract from the other person the prejudices they have, because then is we have a fighting chance to really argue why they think those things, why they say those things, why they believe
them.
How would you punish them is besides the point.
Right, we agree with that, but if you wouldn't, you know, any course, required or otherwise, has the capacity to degenerate into preaching. All of us who have gone to school know that.
Right.
But the question I'm trying to drive at is, how would you do that explicitly? You run a school, after all. How would you do that? How do you create that climate?
Well, I would say one thing, for example, which has been a real issue about free speech on campuses, is what kind of speakers come to campus. This is a big issue. You know, bring a person, Shockley in the old days, you know, a man who won the Nobel Prize, who tries to show in objective, what he thinks objective scientific evidence, that African Americans, blacks, have lower IQs, and that there's a genetic basis for inequality. Now, it seems to me that person should be permitted to speak under rules which are uniform on the campus, which is you can't give a speech unless you're willing to be interrogated without time limit. Get up any stupid thing you want to say up there. You want to say the Holocaust didn't exist? Okay, say it. But then you have to stay in the room without bodyguards, without intimidating people around, and then somebody gets up, and then the university has an obligation. The faculty member in history can't say, well, I want to be at home that night with my spouse. That university person has to be in the audience and prepared to get up and say, okay, Mr. So-and-so, evidence 1-2. So the community actually hears a serious debate. No hit-and-run speech.
What proportion of American universities, particularly those that have promulgated speech codes, do you think run their schools that way?
I would say, but again, I was accused by Professor Stimpson of being too critical, but allow me to be too critical again. That is to say that I think that we do have a problem in the politicization of the administration of universities such that they do not stick and are not permitted to stick by students and faculty. They're not the administrations alone to blame, but there is a lot of cynicism among student groups on all sides and faculty groups who simply want to hear what they already know. And they want to listen to only what they already know, and therefore make it impossible for university administrators to do what they probably are not inclined to do anyway, which is to really promulgate serious rules about how debate is conducted and fostered and inquiry and speech is actually conducted in the university as opposed to any other place.
Okay, Professor Botstein, stop answering and start asking.
Okay. I'm curious about whether you agree, Mr. Glasser. I saw your head shaking in agreement.
I was just trembling.
Mr. Buckley came up with a very interesting challenge to my colleague about Lyndon Johnson and the war criminal. Do you think there's something different about accusing the President of the United States, who's a public figure, something different about that, than hurling epithets at essentially an anonymous student?
Well, sure, there's something different. Public officials, I think, must have a higher tolerance for name-calling and insult and attack than private individuals. But I do think that the reason why I raised that whole issue in the beginning, and the reason why I was nodding in agreement with Mr. Buckley, is that it seems to me that epithets and name-calling have been a part and parcel of our political dialogue since its inception. To look at the newspapers of the 18th century, for example, is to make the tabloids of today look calm by comparison. Name-calling is part of the whole thing. I mean, in fact, not only did people call Lyndon Johnson a war criminal, they burned him in effigy, and nobody confused that with actually killing him and tried people for murder. I mean, that's what metaphor is all about. So that I think that there is a difference between four football players, white, cornering a black female coming home at 12:30 from the library in the corner of a dark building and scaring the hell out of her by using epithets. That is a form of conduct which happens to use words, but which is actionable even though it uses words. But to call someone a name in the course of a hot-blooded debate out on the campus quad is something that is of a piece with the kind of name-calling that went on in every demonstration I ever attended.
Let me move on to another subject Mr. Buckley, your captain, put forward, and that's Mr. Helms and the Mapplethorpe exhibit. He, of course, makes a distinction about his money. I can see that. Would you think that, in fact, tax exemption for art institutions should be removed, or that, in fact, there is, in fact, not some obligation to protect the freedom of expression? Are you selective in your concern for the freedom of expression? Would you agree with him that...
No, I don't agree with him. As for Mr. Helms, he's the one who uses the term baby killer, for example, to refer to women who seek abortion, and that's not a name that anybody has ever suggested who criticizes PC is a problem. And that's just to go to the previous point. As to the money question, I there's a lot of things that my government does that I contribute taxes to that I don't agree with. Why single out speech for the one where I get to have a line item veto power, or he does, I don't understand. It seems to me that the government has the authority to fund the National Endowment on the Arts or not. It has no constitutional obligation to fund artistic speech. But once it funds artistic speech, I do not think it can make distinctions based on politics, based on ideology, based on viewpoint. And I don't think that the argument holds much water, that since I'm contributing my money to it, I get to decide. Otherwise, what about speech in public parks, which is maintained by my tax money, that I don't agree with? Can I also say, that speech is no good because I give tax money to it? I don't think that that's a distinction that holds up when you think about it.
See, you are there for a worthy... We agree you're a worthy opponent because you passed the implicit test that I think Cornel West properly put forward, is there a selective commitment to freedom of expression? That is to say, do you veer off your consistent track of permitting things
God
to be
knows
said?
My hate mail shows there's no selectivity here.
Thanks very much. Thank you. Thank you. Mr. Bork. The opposition team now gets to pretend it's the Senate Judiciary Committee and interrogate Judge Robert Bork.
I'm not under the same constraints I was then.
No, you're not under oath either. Who would like to start? Cornel West, do you have a question?
Not really, though.
Okay. All right.
Is it, by the way, is it Judge Bork, Professor Bork, or Mr. Bork?
As long as it's civil, I don't really care.
Well, that's the answer to what my next question was. We have not yet gotten into one of the aspects of political correctness, which is what people want to be called. Bill Buckley had an interesting column where he would call up a secretary who didn't know him, and sometimes she would say, "Hi, William. Hi, Bill," when you had never met her before, and he was indignant. He wanted to be called Mr. Buckley, as is his right. He's earned it. What do you think about people who used to be called crippled, used to be called handicapped, who asked to be called physically challenged? And what do you think about people of dark pigmentation who used to be called color, used to be called Negro, used to be called black, now want to? They're asking to be called African Americans. Is that appropriate or just political chic?
It's appropriate if they want to ask it. As long as what you're calling them isn't offensive, isn't meant to be offensive, I don't think they have an absolute right to be called what they want to be called.
They don't have an absolute right to be called what they want to be called. So I agree with that. I mean, you can't call me 7 feet tall because it's inaccurate, but why shouldn't a group ask to be called what it wants?
Well, as a matter of fact,
Bill Buckley doesn't want to be called Willie, or Slick Willie, for that matter.
I would never identify him with that. But when you say what they want to be called, what sanction is there for not picking up and calling?
Well, you're mocked as being in a PC police. There's no legal sanction.
I've lost the train here.
I want to come back to this question. I'm still a little bit overwhelmed by my friend William Buckley's candid response to whether the issue of race is a crucial issue in America. Do you think it is? We've got one
race.
Half. Yes.
Well, it was a very tough issue. Then it subsided for a while. Now we're making it a tough issue again. Thank you. One of the things that's increasing racial tensions on campus is precisely affirmative action and speech codes. And students are now segregating themselves at many universities.
Some of the reasons why you hear some hissing is because I think they also have in mind, you got 51.1% of young black children under 6 who live in dire poverty, whose psychic has been associated with children living under conditions of World War II in terms of levels of violence. So when you say it's subsided, are you talking about the explosions in the 60s that alerted us, and because there's been a certain quietism that is no longer a problem, and yet those young children have to live lives every day of quiet riots? I mean, what would be the criteria that would allow you or Mr. Buckley or any other fellow
citizens to
say we don't have
it? We're talking about racial discrimination and racial hostility, I think, aren't we?
I just said race as an issue. There's a variety of different dimensions.
Well, don't worry about race as an issue because, as we now know, there's a white underclass developing that's going to live in the same conditions.
We've always had a white underclass.
No, but it's growing rapidly now, faster than the black underclass is growing.
Leon Botstein.
Well, they're both in such deep trouble that...
Leon Botstein.
Judge Bork, it's a rare opportunity to ask a question which is more open-ended, perhaps. Are there limits?
Don't make it too open-ended.
Yeah. Bill Buckley got around this flag-burning issue by making the deaf mute burn it. I'm curious whether you believe there are limits that are not the technical limits of copyright. But for a
yes.
common citizen, there are limits to First Amendment rights.
Right.
Where you would step in.
Yes. We're talking about flag burning, which is a symbolic act, not speech at all, but we're talking about a symbolic act. If you want to stretch the First Amendment to cover symbolic acts, that's fine. But obviously, some can be prohibited precisely because they're offensive to others. If somebody decides he wants to protest the laws about sodomy by engaging in indecent exposure, I take it we would say that's not protected speech.
But speech, actually, the kind of speech we've been talking about, really, this is about the use of words. I mean,
well,
let's walk away from the symbolic flag burning. And I'm just picking that up as a starting. Are there, you've taken a radical free speech position in this debate, so to speak. In other words, presumably the way it's been set up. That is to say that you're against speech codes and restrictions on campus and so forth and so on. Therefore, I ask you, do you think there are valid grounds for restricting speech?
When speech becomes simply confrontational hostility, the case of the football players who corner a woman and shout epithets at her, or the case of the Brown student who goes out and shouts insults in the middle of the night. Now, I wouldn't, if I learned that that student was making anti-Semitic remarks to his roommate, no, I wouldn't censure him. But when he really disrupts the college atmosphere and makes it hard for people to do what they're there for, then I would.
How about faculty?
Pardon me? Yes.
Faculty. Are the rules different for students and different for faculty?
I don't think so.
Thank you very much, Judge Bork. Professor Greene. And you submit to interrogation by the affirmative team.
Please. Well, why don't I start? Professor Greene, suppose you got a job that Leon Botstein has just described as a horrible job, a college president.
I heard he's having a good time.
But what would be the first two or three things you would do to help bring about a campus that you think would reflect the multicultural realities of America?
Well, I think one thing I would certainly do would be to try to arrange for students to have time to get to know each other even before they would even attend classes. I think that I would require them perhaps to live together with people they had not chosen to live with, maybe rotate them through some type of living arrangement so that they would have an opportunity to spend some time with people who are different, different on all grounds. That's one thing that I would do. I mean, we're talking about we're talking about political correctness, but we're also talking about hate speech. I try to structure some environment generally in which students have a chance to talk to each other one-on-one as people. There was a reference earlier to the problem of separation on our campuses, self-segregation as it's sometimes called. Well, that's a reference to the idea that those students whose very presence at the university is compromised by the promulgation of these epithets feel that they must band together for security. We need to change the atmosphere on campus so that students don't believe they need to react that way. We need to be much more affirmative in our effort to bring students together. The only place students come together is on the basketball court, the football field, where we have the most diverse groups of people working together towards a single goal. We need to bring that sports culture to the rest of the university where people know they have no choice but to live together, to survive together, and to prosper together. So if I were running for president of a university, those would be the sort of things that I would urge that we do, that we intervene affirmatively.
Watch out, you may get one.
Ira Glasser.
Yes, Ira.
Linda, let me ask you something about what you said a little while ago. You decried the transformation of the debate about equality into a debate about censorship.
Yes.
And I could not agree more with that problem. I think it has been a diversion from the underlying problem, as you know. But you said you attributed the cause of that to PCism, which I do to some extent. But what you didn't do, and what I want to ask you is, don't you attribute any of the fault to that to the law professors and the universities that drafted speech codes in the first place? The way the issue came up that first got me talking about censorship and got us into court was because people drafted codes that punished speech that were quite overbroad, and people were thrown out of school for it, and then we had to defend them. That's what transformed it into a censorship debate, and yet you didn't mention that as one of the causative factors.
Well, it's a chicken and egg problem. The hate speech codes are not responsible for intolerance on the university. It
Absolutely.
Is a society in which racism is a fact of life. And so we have hate speech codes as a response, some well-drafted, some not. But we're responding to a larger problem that we have yet to fully address.
But, you know, a university president that I spoke to, in the privacy of his office, told me when I said, you know, if all you can do is draft a narrow speech code to deal with the underlying problem of equality, what really are you doing? And you know what he said to me? He said, we had to throw the black students a bone.
Well, that's an awful thing to say, and that's too bad. Hate speech codes are only one part
could only be one part of a response. I think it would be better if we didn't have to have them, if presidents of universities took the sort of affirmative approach that I describe. I think that we could probably exist without them. And I want to say one more thing, and I am watching the monitor. The other point which was made is that the problems on our campuses and other problems are caused by affirmative action. Affirmative action isn't the problem. The problem is an incomplete development of the principles of Brown, which ought to have provided for an inclusive society in which all people are empowered and not just a few.
Perfect timing. Thank you very much. Catharine Stimpson and Cornel West, please ascend the podiums. And Professor Stimpson, you may question Professor West.
Professor West, Mr. West,
yes,
my friend Cornel.
Brother Cornel. Sister Kat.
Now, Cornel, I'm going to ask you a question, and I would be grateful if you would give me a short answer, because then I'm going to ask a question that's going to give you a chance for a longer answer. Do you agree with my premise throughout this debate that the debate about political correctness, the debate about political correctness has been a menace and a bore?
It has displaced, I think, the crucial issues. I think the one insight that we can learn from, especially our conservative fellow citizens, is that any form of orthodoxy precludes the kind of public dialogue that we must have. That's the one insight.
Now, let's go on. We as a country desperately need a national conversation about our values, about our good differences, about our bad differences, about our unities. How would you construct that conversation? How would you bring us together to talk about our differences and our unities in a way that avoids false polarizations and idiocies?
I think we'd have to appeal to the best of our traditions, and that for me has to do with a radical democratic tradition, a way in which public life is constituted. I think a jazz band, a quintet, a quartet might be a model here, since jazz is a great democratic art form in which we actually listen to one another. We enter not by highlighting our identities and constituencies, but as members of constituencies and bearers of identities, we highlight public mindedness because we're involved in something bigger than us. And like jazz players, we summons from one, not simply reacting, but creatively responding, keeping in mind something that is larger than us. And that is very rare in a highly polarized and balkanized society. And yet there's, of course, millions of fellow citizens who are attempting to do this against the odds.
Say I was very poor. Say I had no access to the media. How would you bring me into the conversation? You have written passionately about the underprivileged, about those without a voice. How would you empower the voiceless?
One would have to be part of a network or be organized. That one of the distinctive features of being disadvantaged in American society is disorganization. It's always ironic to look at the powerful and the wealthy dangling the rugged, ragged, rapacious individualism, but they're the most organized sector of our society. You see, the poor are very disorganized, and hence it's very difficult for them to gain the kind of self-confidence, sense of empowerment, sense of possibility, sense of hope. And so you have to become part of a network, part of an organization. Of course, in the black community, the black church is very important in this regard, but it has no monopoly on providing some possibility for a poor person who seems as if they're dangling, they're rootless, they're drifting, and hence feeling as if they do not make a difference. The worst thing that could happen in a democracy is for citizens to feel as if they don't make a difference. Because once that kind of helplessness sets in, then the rage, the anger, and the fury begins to take the xenophobic channels that we know have unraveled every democracy since the beginning of humanity.
Why don't you now go on the offensive and ask some questions to Ms. Stimpson?
Yes. My question would be, though, very similar to the question you asked me, that is to say, given the history of patriarchy in American society, what are the various ways in which one can constitute a genuine conversation, even as one comes to terms with the tragic facts of American past and present relation to patriarchy?
Well, Cornel, to my regret, it's not just patriarchy.
No, that's true.
That as we look at, oh, I'm not going to sit here and indulge in America bashing. But I think we have to distinguish between America bashing and looking at our sins and crimes. And if our sins and crimes were limited to the patriarchy, we would be better off than we are now. It seems to me there are a couple of things we can do. One is the curriculum. One is what we teach. And if we can teach history, neither is the record of grandeur, nor is the record of folly and sin. But if we can teach history as it is, where we struggle against our follies and sins, and sometimes we succeed and sometimes we don't, if we can teach complexity from pre-kindergarten on, that would be an advantage. A second thing I think we have to do is this. We have to construct groups where we can come to terms with our hostilities. I teach in a public university. I teach a lot of young white men, and they sometimes have an insufficient place to talk about the threats and fears that they feel. And I think if we're going to make a democracy work, we have to have safe public spaces in which we can talk about our fears, talk about our anxieties, and talk about our hostilities in ways that don't translate it into axe murdering or power games.
A shift level gain, the level of wisdom, which in part the university should be about anyway, as it were.
Well, not just the universities. If we leave the gaining and getting of wisdom to the universities, we're in trouble.
We're in deep trouble. Yes.
All our institutions have to engage in that.
Then how then do we account for the predominance of PC talk?
Well, I was asked that question earlier, Cornel.
Yeah.
How do we account for the dominance of PC talk? I gave one answer, which is it became a media feeding frenzy.
But is it just that, though? Is
no,
it deeper?
No, it wasn't just that.
Is it deeper, I'm wondering.
Yeah, it wasn't just that,
yeah.
And I'm so glad you asked me. It was an act of friendship, because now I can expand.
Yes, exactly.
There was some PC there. There really was. There have been mistakes across the political spectrum. And I'm not going to stand here with seven people and the moderator looking at me and say that all has been sweetness and light on the campus. What we call PC, an attempt to write speech codes, for example, did happen. It was regrettable, but it did happen. So there was material there to be used. There were stories there to be told. But the real reason, I think, is what I said before. We as a country, in an interdependent world, are wrestling with the most difficult possible social, cultural, psychological, and economic issues. And we're wrestling with them in a time where we have no certain roadmaps. We're wrestling with issues that have a public dimension and a psychological dimension. Sexism, racism, homophobia, all the isms. Those don't disappear by snapping our fingers or changing our laws. So that we are working with very difficult historical and psychological material. And I think everybody wants to avoid it if they can. And the PC debate was a way of talking about it and not talking about it at the same time.
Don't speak about the PC debate in the past tense. We're still going. Thank you very much, both of you. We've now reached the moment for closing arguments, and since Mr. Buckley always gets the last word, since it's his program, it's time for Mark Greene to give the closing argument against the resolution.
How long do I have, Michael? Depending on the quality of my remarks, or
depending
like
on the quality of your
time.
Remarks, 2.5 minutes or more.
I think it has been shown why the resolution has failed. Both sides agreed, with a few exceptions, but. Any future debates, I think, should be better informed by a sense of proportion. Yes, the University of Connecticut had a code prohibiting inappropriate laughter. And I think I hear some
go,
of it right now.
Ahead.
Right. And that's just silly and indefensible. But the American Council on Education said that of all the 3,500 campuses in the country, 3% had controversies over curriculum, 4% had controversies over textbooks, and 36% had gender and racial bias incidents. In other words, contrary to Mr. Buckley, but
in my objective view, consistent with Professor Cornel West, it is 1,000 times worse, 1,000,000 times worse, that half of black children live in poverty than that some conservative professor allegedly may have not been promoted as quickly as he or she otherwise thought. In other words, think of an Empire State Building and think of a hut, and the debate over political correctness is the hut. Second, we didn't really get into the issue of diversity in curricula, that it's okay to teach W.E.B. Du Bois and Jane Austen both without undermining education. But given the doubling of the percentage of women with children in the workforce, given that East Asia market in 20 years will double that of Europe, given that 75% of America is white, but only 1/3 of the world is white, PC is correct in trying to diversify curricula and the campuses, because that's where the markets are. Just to prove to Bill Buckley that I can be an adherent and advocate of capitalism, because markets speak very loudly. Finally, I really do think Mr. Buckley gave away the store when he said it was okay to suppress speech he doesn't like called flag burning, but not okay to suppress speech that others here may not like and he doesn't like called racial epithets. It was consistent with my opening comment that the issue in PC comes down to whose orthodoxy is gored, and I think Ira Glasser and myself and those of us who take a more even-handed approach of the First Amendment, that is, it protects liberals and conservatives alike, are more right. So to conclude, I'm amused to see that those whose ideology has so often censured speech from McCarthy to Helms, those who poisoned the well of liberty, now come before us as water commissioners. The issue is not political correctness so much as it is patriotic correctness, and that chills speech more than anything we've discussed tonight. Thank you.
Mr. Buckley, close for the affirmative team.
Mr. Chairman, I think I've told you like maybe 100 times that the rules of debate are that the affirmative speaker speaks first and last, irrespective of whether his name is Buckley.
But the question is, why is it that the man named Mr. Buckley is always on the affirmative side?
I so will it. What we're talking about, ladies and gentlemen, is of course taboo. Now, I happen to believe in taboos. I hope I've never said to a fat woman you're fat or to a homely girl that she's homely. I believe in taboos on the whole. But we're trying to get to the bottom of the question whether or not the current taboos, which go by the name of political correctness, are actually obstructing avenues of inquiry in which we have a genuine and legitimate interest. I love Professor Botstein's solution to this. You gotta make sure if somebody comes in with a point of view of shocking, to have somebody else right next to him who contradicts him. This would make for a very interesting library. You can't have Das Kapital without Adam Smith sort of glued on to it. These synthetic solutions sound good, but they don't really work. The fact of the matter is that PC, in fact, continues to govern. 2 days ago, the President of the United States gave a speech about AIDS, how awful it was, which it is. And he gave the instance of two people who he knew had died of AIDS. Were they two women? What if they died of contaminated blood? Because he didn't want to talk about the fact that the primary incidence of AIDS is among homosexuals. By the same token, we have Professor West saying 51.1% of the black people in America are in poverty. Did he say that the chances of getting poverty is 600% increased if you are illegitimate, and that 62% of black births are illegitimate? No, he didn't. He didn't say that because it's kind of taboo to mention this. A friend of mine walked into Trinity College last week. He's an urbane gentleman. He's been around. He went to visit his son. There was a huge banner, 20 feet long, floating along the archway coming to the country. I said, homophobia sucks. So he said to a friend of his with the administration, that really isn't the kind of vernacular one expects to see, sort of standing guard over the entrance to a college. He said, no, that's true. It's not. But if we were to take it down, the Red Guards of PC would be at us within 5 minutes. So he said, well, what if one were to put up a thing saying homosexuality sucks? Oh, my goodness, he said. You would never get away with that for 5 minutes. Now, I don't think either banner should be floated. And I reach for a formula by which one can take that position without coming out against the First Amendment or against being against flag burning, being pro-Mablethorpe. The sentiments of that kind, if people feel that they've got to express them, otherwise they will simply throttle down with frustration, should be in men's rooms or in the Village Voice, either one. This is the formula that we need to explore, and we need to remind ourselves that taboos can be good, they can be protective, they can be civilized, but they can also hinder inquiries into important questions.
Thank you, Mr. Buckley. Well, there's only one person whose freedom of speech has been constrained for the past couple of hours, and that's me. But I have a couple of seconds left, and besides thanking all our panelists who did an outstanding job, I'd like to make a couple of points. First of all, Claire Fagan, the acting president of the University of Pennsylvania, expressed the hope at the beginning of this debate that the University of Pennsylvania will start to put water buffaloes behind it. I don't know whether that will be successful or not, but I think we all share that hope. Secondly, when it's interesting, when I was at the university, it was people on the right who were saying that universities should maintain a higher standard of civility than society at large, and the fact that universities were voluntary associations permitted codes to be imposed on them that would violate First Amendment principles in society at large. That seems to have switched. It's now the left that's saying that, and the right that's claiming to be the voice of freedom of expression. You also have the interesting fact that Mr. Buckley, who wrote his book, God and Man at Yale, 40 years ago, we never did find out whether he still believes that academic freedom is a superstition, but we don't have time to find that out. You'll have to come back to the next one. Thank you very much for the audience and to the United States, University of Pennsylvania. Thank you very much.
This program was a Warren Stiebel production in association with South Carolina ETV. Funding for this firing line debate was made possible by a grant from the John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated, the Annenberg Foundation, the Laurel Foundation, and the Pappas Lecture Fund of the University of Pennsylvania. For a video cassette of this two-hour debate, send $49.50 to Firing Line, 2700 Cypress Street, Columbia, South Carolina, 29205. State the subject of the debate and please allow 3 weeks for delivery.
This is PBS.
For a transcript of this two-hour debate, send $10 to Firing Line, 2700 Cypress Street, Columbia, South Carolina, 29205. State the subject of the program and please allow 3 weeks for delivery.